Next up, I'm going to welcome to the stage Dave Tagare, and we're going to be talking a little bit about the streaming platform at Lyft and the team that he runs there. So welcome.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Glad to be here.
So maybe you could start and tell us a little bit about your role at Lyft and your experiences with open source and what led you to this.
Right. So I've been with Lyft for about a year now. I am one of the eng managers on the stream platform team. We do everything from ingestion to pub/sub to fanouts to persistence, all in real time. What brought me to Lyft? I think it was scaling distributed systems with really low end-to-end latencies. And Lyft is a real-time and a streaming-first company, so that was really interesting for me to sort of pursue.
Yeah, it's one of the most fascinating use cases for event streams in my mind. You know, I really think in that dichotomy of kind of using software and becoming software, you know, this is a company that really started fresh, taking something that we knew, which is how do you get a ride somewhere, and turning it into an end-to-end software-driven experience. And one of the most interesting kind of real-time logistics challenges to route all these cars all around the world globally and optimize all the pickups. So maybe you could tell us a little bit about the technology evolution at Lyft. You know, where did you start? Where are you at today? Kind of where are you going? What's the event streaming, you know, stack look like for you guys?
Sure. So Lyft basically has been a Kinesis shop for a really long time, and we still continue to be. At the same time, we sort of realized that if we wanted to index on lower tail latencies like 50 ms or under, we couldn't really, you know, continue being on a single pub/sub stack. At that point, that was really unlocking new use cases that sort of took us to Kafka. And with adding Kafka in addition to Kinesis at Lyft, what we were able to do was get really, really cool end-to-end latencies, 50 ms and lower. At the same time, we could sort of leverage high fanouts, which usually end up being expensive. You have to write some systems to take a stream of events, fan them out to different consumers or downstream applications. These could be microservices. These could be some real-time decision-making models, pricing models, ETA models. So we didn't really want to manage all of that infrastructure anymore, and it gets clunkier and clunkier as you add more and more microservices. That was basically our tipping point, and we said, okay, we need to add Kafka to the toolkit, and it's really unlocked a bunch of use cases for us.
And where do you think it's going? Do you think you'll be using more Kafka in the future?
Oh yeah, definitely. Kafka usage is definitely on the rise. We started last year with a vendor-managed solution, Confluent Cloud, and then further along, we sort of went down the path of adding in-house Kafka support as well. And as of today, we're running between Confluent Cloud and our in-house clusters about 11 clusters. And Kafka is taking close to 100 billion rides a day now.
That's awesome. And anything you can tell me about these use cases in more depth? What are some of the things that you're using event streams to do? And what's, you know, some of the volume and scale for these users?
Yeah, definitely. So in terms of volume and scale, we, depending on the time of day, day of the week, in a given day, we do about 95 to 150, 160 billion events. Most of this is real time. They feed into either real time decision making services or microservices, or they sometimes get into real time or near real time persistence paths, or they're just fanned out to something like a location on your cell phone, which is one of the coolest use cases we have with Kafka running today. And it was really Kafka that sort of enabled that use case. What happens is we have a bunch of location ingestion services. They feed into a Kafka cluster. And what we end up doing is we take all of that data. We try to map match a user location with a road segment to correctly know which intersection, which side of the road you're on, stuff like that. Because all of those decisions go into dispatching a ride for you, or if you're one of the passengers in a shared ride, then we want to know that, oh, it's a one-way, you're on this side of the road, so right, map you to the right segment. For those use cases, well, after we persist all those locations in Kafka, we run parallel models. Yeah. Now, these are models which run with a fan-out factor of 100, 200, 500 sometimes, and the best model wins, it accurately matches you to the right segment of the road, and then from that point on, you're either matched with a the right driver, or if you're a driver, you're matched with the right rider, and that's that model wins. That projected location is sent back to your cell phone, both for the rider and the passenger, and then one cool thing that happens is the little car that moves on your screen, Kafka powers that car.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
That's really cool. So I'd love to hear a little bit about your approach at Lyft towards managed services. So when I was at LinkedIn, you know, we kind of, I guess, copied Google, and we wanted to build everything in-house. You know, now the world is very different, where there's much more available in open source. There's, you know, kind of managed offerings that you can get in the cloud that are just kind of run and scaled for you. Like, how do you guys think about that? When do you choose one or the other?
Right. I mean, technology at Lyft is very democratic. We believe in, like, having a different, you know, array of tools in our toolkit, really. So the reason we chose a vendor-based offering when we first started, being Confluent Cloud, was we more immediately wanted to unlock some of the mission-critical and high business value or business impact use cases. For those, usually we index on high levels of reliability, better availability guarantees, and just sometimes, you know, things go wrong and you need vendor coverage and vendor support. So anything that is user-facing, ride-impacting, needs really high latency and durability guarantees, we index on vendor support.
That's great.
For some of the lower high velocity but lower sort of importance use cases, we did invest in adding some in-house tooling, and we spun up in-house Kafka as well.
And what's, you know, is there any way to characterize the impact of this transition to Kafka? Like, what has it, you know, done for the business? Is there anything that can be said about that?
Right, yeah. I mean, the pivot to Kafka, or adding Kafka to our toolkit, basically unlocked a bunch of use cases that would normally have not been unlocked. Like, if you want to do map matching in under 100 MS, you need to have locations data sent out to the routing models within 30, 40 MS. That means your write latency plus your consume latency needs to be an order of magnitude lower than some of like the previous pub sub systems. They guaranteed about 500 MS P99s. You need it to be within 50 MS. So yep. That's the stuff yep. that got unlocked for us. The car really moves smoothly because we could do that in 100 yep. MS. Another thing that it unlocked for us on the AV front was we sort of like map these images and index them in S3. And after that, we run a bunch of image processing models. Those run with fan-out factors of 2,000.
Yeah.
When you need low latencies and higher fan-out factors with economics of scale, like Kafka was a natural choice for us.
That's great. So Kafka is in that path towards self-driving cars then.
Definitely is, yeah.
That's cool. So any advice that you would have for your peers, based on the experiences you guys have had so far? Anything that you want to share about what you've learned or what's coming up?
Yeah, so in terms of just advice to the peers, what I would say is be realistic about your use case, what Kafka can do for you and what it cannot do for you. Don't try to over-engineer with Kafka. Like, it's a tool that works really well. At Lyft, we sort of philosophically think about Kafka as a reliability tool, as in it transports data from point A to point B reliably. It's always available. So we really invested in a lot of tooling around Kafka. We have a offset lag monitor, end-to-end latency monitors, rebalancers, and remediators. So for some of our in-house Kafka tooling, that's a thing that we invested in, wherein if there's a network partition fault, the remediator kicks in and spins up, restarts the process or spins up a node. So stuff like that, I would definitely advise everyone who wants to use Kafka to work on. And just be honest about your SLOs. Sometimes you just don't need all those 8.9s.
Yeah, that's great. Well, for anybody who wants to learn more about Kafka at Lyft, I believe you're going to be doing a talk later this afternoon, and people definitely should check out that session.
Yeah, definitely.
All right.
Looking forward.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.